Hello, today's video is maybe the start of a new series, underrated albums, to me, underrated albums. And the first one I'm going to talk about is this one. I've always got it here near my working desk because I even like the cover, I like to look at the cover. It's Whatever's For Us by Joan Armatrading, Trading, her debut album. Of course, Joan Armatrading later on, especially late 70s, early 80s, would have some success, you know, one might say even big success here and there. But I think overall she's still, to this day, a very underrated artist. She would have deserved even more success. And this first album, Whatever's For Us, was a big, big flop. No one really, it didn't show up in any charts. And the backstory of that album is, in my opinion, quite interesting. You know, we have to start in the early 50s, or I think in the year 1950, when I think it was 1950 when Joan Armatrading was born, in the Caribbean. She grew up on a Caribbean island and moved to London in the late 60s, and then she. There she got a role in the stage version of the musical Hair in London. There she met a girl, Pam Nestor, which was around the same age, and they had even other things in common because Pam Nestor was from also immigrated a few years back from Guyana, which is also it's in South America, but also near the Caribbean, so they had a kind of similar heritage. And they were both into music, of course, because they met at Hair, at the musical. And soon they started to befriend each other and started writing songs together. And they decided to form a duo. They made some demos, sent them to record labels, and quickly got signed because the quality of those demos. Well, you know, those were the songs from that first album. Brilliant songs. It was easy for them to get a record contract. But then trouble started because they wanted to be a duo, like not a single solo artist, Joan Armatrading. The plan was Pam Nestor and Joan Armatrading. But quickly the record label and the management wanted Pam Nestor out. No one really knows why, because there was nothing wrong with her. She was, by all accounts, a pleasant girl, a nice person, and she wrote about 40% of that album. You know, she wrote maybe more lyrics, and Joan Armatrading contributed more music, but you know, it was also the other way around. She had a big, big imprint on that album. And she's even, you know, even it's built, you know, it's a Joan Armatrading album, but she's even on the back cover. That's Pam Nestor, that's Joan Armatrading. So maybe all that turmoil of her being sacked from the duo during or even after the production of that album was could have been reasons why this album was so didn't do anything, because it's a brilliant album. It's one of my favorite singer-songwriter albums of all time. It has this great Elton John, Cat Stevens vibe, you know, the good Elton John stuff from the early 70s, you know, songs like My Family. It's like this Tiny Dancer kind of Elton John, which was, of course, the best Elton John. And even people from Elton's group of musicians and Cat Stevens musicians worked on that album, so it also has this warm analog sound, lots of, you know, it's piano based and sometimes acoustic guitar based, but it's always a great band in the background, great bass playing, great drums on Visionary Mountains, even sitar bits. So it's a ri very rich, warm production with lots of detail. But you know, the songs themselves are really what makes this, or even, you know, that's the key reason why this is such a great album. The song It Could Have Been Better, it's probably one of my top five ever songs ever. Other songs like City Girl, Head of the Table, All the King's Gardens. All the King's Gardens has a bit of a Stevie Wonder vibe to it. You know, it's such a good album. It's so underrated in my opinion. It's Joanna Ma Trading's best album, in my opinion. She made lots of albums and lots of good albums, but this is her best album. But as I said, after that album, Pam Nester was kind of sidelined. I think there are two or three Pam Nester co-written songs on the second album, but after that she was out, and that's really unfortunate. You know, I think they should have continued to work together. It's a strange tale of you know, music business, the dirty parts of the music business. But well, it's, you know, at least this album, I think one could say, was a very influential album, because artists like Tracy Chapman, maybe even Alanis Morissette, who sold like hundreds of millions of records, I think they must have been very inspired or influenced by that album. But yeah, very unfortunate that this album didn't do better. But you know, I really recommend it to you if you haven't yet heard that album. And if you like what you hear, you should, you know, chronologically, you should buy more and more Joanna Ma Trading albums, because she's really a great, great artist, and especially that early, mid, late 70s work, you know, that 70s work of hers, I really think is outstanding. Yeah, that was the first part of this kind of series. Let's see if I will pick more albums in the future, but I think it's kind of an interesting way of looking at things, you know, those underrated albums and the stories behind them. So, thank you for watching.